In this video, I am sharing 8 vibe coding practices you can't afford to skip. Trust me, if you follow these practices, you will not run into the situations like these social media posts. If you are looking to improve your vibe coding approach, or vibe coding does not work for you like it works for others, this video is for you, and these practices apply regardless of which vibe coding tool or AI-powered IDE you use. Let's get started with a basic rule: know your tools. And your tool for vibe coding is an AI code agent like Cursor, GitHub Copilot, Windsurf, etc. You know that these AI agents are powered by LLMs, so they share the same limitations. For example, context windows. They forget your instructions and previously provided information. They hallucinate and make things up and assert falsehood as if they were true. And sometimes they may not have up-to-date information. So your first must-do practice is to stay in control of your project from start to end. This means that you practically take the roles of a project manager, a system architect, a lead developer, a QA engineer, and a very good prompt engineer, while you treat your AI code agent just as a junior developer. And don't worry if you haven't been in these roles. These roles are not those conventional roles. You will get help from your LLM. How? Every next practice will clarify this. Take a look at this Reddit post. Vibe coding a whole app is a trap. I could never vibe code an entire app from start to finish. Sure, it feels magical at first. Just throw a prompt at your favorite AI and boom, you've got something working. But the second you need to implement a new feature or tweak something significant, you are knee deep in refactor hell. No structure, no consistency, and good luck figuring out what that one function was even doing. This user is not alone complaining this. Why does this happen? This happens because you do not stay in control of your project. Rather, you delegate the control to the AI, the LLM. Whatever you are developing, a new product, an MVP, a new feature in an existing app, and whatnot, you must always have a development plan. Our second must-do practice of vibe coding is be a good project manager and do not develop without a development plan. And for a good development plan, you must run a requirement clarification round with your LLM. Have the LLM make you a development plan with clear deliverables for each phase. Let me show you how this works. To show you the process of making a development plan with the help of AI code agent or the LLM, I will use an expense sharing application idea, and you will see that how easy it is to quickly develop a development plan with a little dedicated effort. First, very quickly, I'm going to show you the recipe of disaster. I have this prompt: create a single app that lets groups of friends, roommates, and travel companions track shared expenses and automatically calculate who owes what to whom. This is an overly simplified prompt, but it serves the purpose of showing you how these LLMs work. I hit enter, and you see that my AI agent doesn't hesitate in making decisions on its own, even with this very vague prompt, which doesn't clarify the business requirements, nor it specify any technical requirements. But the LLM or the AI agent has just taken some decisions and started generating the code. This will surely result in a working application, but it's definitely not what I had in my mind. It's the result of what the LLM thought and decision it made. If I continue building upon this code base using this kind of prompts, this will result in a spaghetti code base, a messed up code base. And down the line, I will certainly be in trouble. And even my AI agent will not be able to figure out what to do next, how to fix the bugs, and I will be helpless. I will now show you how to correctly vibe code this expense sharing application. Look at this prompt for requirement clarification. I have explicitly mentioned that the LLM has to first share its understanding of the requirements with me. This is because it makes sure that the LLM goes through the given requirements thoroughly and doesn't make assumptions on its own. And when it shares its understanding, I can read through it and rectify it. In the next line, I have also instructed it that do not start coding until we have agreed upon the development plan. I've done this so because these LLMs love to take actions on their own. Let's run this prompt, and we have the response. You see that the LLM has straight away raised the technical implementation related questions that I don't want. So I am going to instruct it to focus on the business requirement first. Awesome. This time the LLM has analyzed the business requirements very well, and it has even come up with questions for clarification. Now I'm going to answer these questions, and I will ask it to generate a final requirement specification document. So after a couple of iterations, I have now this final requirement specification document. Similarly, I went through a couple of iterations to decide about the tech stack and other technical details. So I have this technical requirement specification final document. Now that I am confident that my LLM has correct understanding of business and technical requirements, I'm going to ask it to generate an incremental step-by-step development plan. Here you go. So we have a development plan with 12 phases, and we also have deliverable and success criteria mentioned for each of the phases. During this whole brainstorming process, I kept saving all the important points and responses from the LLM to my Notion documents. This is our must-do practice number 3. Do not trust the LLM's memory. Keep note of every important point, because LLMs have a context window. They have limited memory, and they tend to forget the context after their context limit arrives. So it is very important to keep all the important information during your project execution, planning, and development, both phases. You must save all the important information in your own documents so that if the LLM loses the context, you can provide the exact information back to the LLM. And this will save you a lot of time in case the LLM forgets your previous instructions or the agreed upon plan of development. Now that you have a well-structured application development plan, the next must do is to execute this plan phase by phase. It's very important to review the code at every phase and test the deliverables of each phase. Your code review should be as thorough as you would do for a human developer. This white coder had lost all of his work of last 2 weeks. 2 weeks of hard work completely ruined. I really don't want you to be in this situation. Therefore, I have the must-do number 5 for you. Always use version control, whether you are doing wipe coding or normal coding. Commit code frequently, not only at the end of a phase, but between the phases also. And revert to a working code whenever you feel that your LLM has broken something. Practice number 6. You and the LLM must be on the same page. You have to do 2 major activities in this regard. Number 1, ask the LLM to evaluate the phase completion. And number 2, before starting the next phase, ask the LLM to reprint the phase plan to make sure that LLM has not lost the context. Otherwise, it may mess up the things. And if it has lost the context, feed the phase plan back to LLM from your docs. But still, if the things have messed up somehow, then comes the practice number 7 to your rescue. Polish your debugging skills. The AI agents or the LLMs can fix many types of bugs, but not always. Stay ready to jump in to help your AI code agent, the junior developer. You have to stay in control, so your debugging skills are very much needed. Last but not the least, probably the most scary one, practice number 8, ensure security compliance at every phase. Why scary? Take a look at this viral story. Guys, I am under attack. Ever since I started to share how I built my SaaS using Cursor, random things are happening. Maxed out usage on API keys, people bypassing the subscription, creating random shit on DB. As you know, I'm not technical, so this is taking me longer than usual to figure out. Well, after this much hard work, after ensuring all the best practices, you don't deserve to be in a situation like this one. But the fact is that you are the owner and are responsible for ensuring the security compliance of your code, the test coverage of your application, network and cloud security of your infrastructure, compliance with user privacy frameworks like GDPR, and you must always ensure that your code follows general programming best practices and guidelines. Thanks for watching. If you found this video helpful, be sure to like and subscribe. I'm Atif, and I'll see you in the next one.